planning this evening, so just hang on to your hats. We'll go through this really fast.
And your wallet.
And your wallet. I will mention the fact, though, that thank you very much for pointing out that Jamie Damon got a whole bunch of money from the unions and she lost. Once he gets it, here it is right here. He's got it queued up. The 2015 session, what did it do to you? Low carbon fuel standard. Everybody heard about it, right? Low carbon fuel standard would not let us do transportation. We almost had it fixed, but this is a fee, a gas charge to you that will go to the state, and the state will use it for low carbon fuel reduction, but it won't fix roads. State says it's going to cost between 4 and 19 cents. Transportation people say up to $1.06. So that's going to cost. Can you flip the slide, please? There you go. It's going to cost between $44 million and $1.17 billion a year as soon as this gets up to work. Now, DEQ can't make it work yet, but once it gets up to speed, that's what it's going to cost us. So you can expect your gas prices to go up. Next slide, please. In 2015, we passed a $55 fee for automobile policy, $100 million into the pockets of lawyers, because that's what it did. Basically, it allows you to get more, if you're hurt in an accident, it allows you to get more than what you would deserve. It's going to cost everybody $55. My policy just went up $49. Everybody that gets a new policy for next year, for this year, you'll see it. Next slide, please. We talked about BOLI. BOLI is what I call BOLI the Bully. We passed so that they can do warrants, liens, and garnishments on you if an employer or an employee has a wage claim against you. Or if, for example, Sweetcase comes in, they could do a lien and wage claim. We have given them tremendous strength to do stuff to take away your rights as an employer and as a person.
Terrible.
Next thing. Next one. Mandatory. I call it mandatory time off. Everybody says it's mandatory sick leave. It's really mandatory time off. Because you can take off if you got a sniffle, a cold, a sneeze. If you have to go down to court, if you have to go get your tires rotated, you can take that time off. Every employee earns 1 hour for every 30 hours they work. Whether you're part-time, seasonal, or full-time, you get 1 hour for every 30 hours you work. And basically what we did is we added one more week to the payroll paycheck. 52 weeks a year, now it's 53. That cost, predicated by legislative revenue office at the bottom, that will cost employers $2.231 billion a year. Guess where that money's gonna come from? We pay it all, folks.
Yep.
We pay it all. House Bill 2700, it's not really an important one for most of us, but it expanded class action suits, and the reason they did it was British Petroleum has been sued in a class action suit. It's in litigation. They saw a big pot of money sitting in the background, and they retroactively passed this law so they could go back and get BP's money, take it out of their pocket. Once again, pay off to the lawyers. You know, we talked about unions, how much money they put in. Lawyers put an inordinate amount of money into campaigns. They get paid for it. Next one. Workers' comp fee. Anybody that's got a business, your workers' comp fee went up, cost you $1.9 million more, the whole state. So when you add all of these things up, just for what we did in 2015, $2.37 billion to $3.5 billion in new costs to Oregonians per year because of the legislation we passed in 2015. And a lot of the legislation was very partisan. Republicans did not vote on a single bit of this. We didn't like the mandate. We didn't like BOLI. We did not like the low carbon fuel standard because it really does nothing for Oregon. But what's critical is what's coming up in 2016. We know it's an election year. We know that we're going to have a new president, and hopefully it's the right one. And I don't know what the right one is, but it's the right one, the right one. But let's look at where the state is right now. We talked about the fact that schools, number 15 graduation rate, terrible. We have 1 in 5 Oregonians on food stamps, terrible. They talk about the fact that it's exciting to have a very low unemployment rate, 5%. But those are all low-paying jobs, $9 and $10 an hour jobs. People can't live on that. Steve talked about that and the expense of rent down in Portland. We can't live on it. So what do we got coming up? We've got a lot of stuff coming up, but let's look what basically where we're at. Back up, just one. Where we're at, PERS is underfunded by $18 billion right now. Next biennium, it will be underfunded by $20 billion. Oh, by the way, the governor gave all state employees, if you're a state employee, very good, you got a $628 million raise.
Unions helped with that.
Unions helped with that, but because you know what? AFSCME and SEIU are the unions that benefit from this.
Yes, ma'am.
So they pushed this forward. Now remember this, Social Security did not go up this year. No cost of living adjustment. Minimum wage, no cost of living adjustment. But state employees will get a 2.25% raise next year and a 2.75% COLA the year after that, on top of their step increase, which is 3.85%. Total $628 million. So where are we going to get that money? Let's take a look. And remember this, and I'm trying to go really fast because I know John wants to get out of here in time. First off, you know that we've got the minimum wage. Next slide, please. First off, you know that we've got the minimum wage coming up. And the nice thing about this minimum wage is there's going to be a ballot measure out there for $15 an hour, but the legislature says, hey, maybe we can make this a little bit better. We have the second highest minimum wage in the nation at 9 1/4, but they want to go to $11. So for an employer, going to $11 an hour is an 18.9% increase. But on top of that, if you're an employer, you understand that you have overhead costs because of that. So that's another 18.9% that you're going to go up, because now you have to pay increased FICA taxes, increased unemployment taxes, increased workers' comp taxes. Oh, by the way, if you live down here in this area, you're going to pay increased TriMet taxes. All of that's going to come out of your pocket. But now if you've got employees that are sitting there at $13 an hour, because they worked for you for a few years, and suddenly everything bumps to 11, do they want to stay at 13? No, they're going to go up. So your costs are going to go up with it. Legislative Revenue Office says if we go up to $15 an hour, that will be a $3 billion hit to our economy. $3 billion. And where's it going to come from? Anybody have any idea? Just raise your hand, because you'll pay it. Next, please. Now we've got Restore Oregon. What Restore Oregon wanted was to get off of coal generation for electricity and be 50% renewable by 2040. Coal has to go away by 2030, renewable by 2040. Now, the significance of that is the fact that, first off, renewable is not a base load energy. We're sitting here now, it's dark outside. So the sun's not shining, solar is not generating, and the wind is not blowing. So where are we getting our electricity from? We're getting it from our old reliable source, which was coal. And when we're off of that, it'll be natural gas. Natural gas will be our single source of baseline power. Single source. Now, as a sidebar, you know when one of the refineries up in Washington goes down for our gasoline, you know what it does to our gas prices? They go up. They go up astronomically. So if someone were to take out that single source of gas, which is natural gas, take it out, like a terrorist, guess what our electric rates would do? And how would we have electricity? When you get up at 3 in the morning to go to the bathroom and you want to turn the light on, is it going to be there? No, because renewables will not do it. And our electric rates will change. Now, I just got the deal on it. They've already negotiated this deal. PG Pacific Corp have already negotiated this deal with the environmentalists. We weren't at the table. Consumers were not at the table. Does PG and PacifiCorp like it? Yes, of course they do, because as we mandate that they purchase renewable energy, they get a guaranteed return on investment. So we have to pay for the solar power, the wind power that we're buying. We have to pay for their equipment purchase. Then we have to guarantee that we will pay them between 8 and 11% return on their investment for the next 30 years. What do you think your rates are going to do in the next 10 years or so? They're going to skyrocket. Once again, the amazing thing about all of this, had we said that hydropower was a renewable resource, we wouldn't have to do anything, because we've already met our goals. But we don't count hydropower. We don't count the dams on the river.
Why?
The reason we don't do it is because they would not then have to require us to put in solar and wind, because we had already met our requirements. Steve?
Yeah, it's funny, a lot of the left who likes this sort of thing, they point at Germany and other countries as a model for adapting to renewables. But Germany considers hydro renewable.
It does, yeah. But the interesting thing about Germany is they found out that they're taking away their nuclear power plants. And you remember, we banned nuclear. They're taking away the nuclear power plants. Their power costs are 40% higher than the rest of the European nations. And so it's very difficult for them to compete in the world. It'd be just as difficult for us to compete outside of the state of Oregon. Yes?
Yeah, Germany's GDP just crashed in the last 4 years from 4% to about 0.5%.
Well, they're kind of on our trajectory then with our president. So that deal has been negotiated. Now it needs to come to the legislature. And they're so proud of it because they think we'll pass it. And I'm really mad about it, to be honest with you. And I can understand why the utilities wanted to do this. Everybody hates coal. They polled it. Everybody in Oregon hates coal.
I don't.
It's a done deal. So, but the thing about it is when you read the fine print, you find out that the utilities, PacifiCorp and PGE, will be putting in electric charging stations. And the ratepayers, you and I, will pay for it. And other people did it privately, they're out of business. Because there's only 3,600 electric cars in Oregon. But the Oregon Global Warming Commission expects that we'll have over 1 million cars in Oregon by 2035. So, what's coming after that that's going to impact us? Now remember, a low carbon fuel standard was a tax. They call it a fee, but it's a tax on your energy to drive your car. What we've got coming up next is what they call cap and trade. We want to cap the carbon dioxide emissions that are put out by people that have permits. And then we will tell them their cap, and I'll give an example. If your cap, if you put out 100,000 tons, metric tons of CO2, we will bump you down to 90,000 tons. Now you know you can't get there unless you quit producing what you're producing and lay people off. So we will let you buy credits. Now this program, remember the mortgage program we had where people were bundling mortgages and then selling them on and on and on? That's what cap and trade is all about. You don't solve the problem, you just make somebody pay for it. So the cap and trade program, what it will do, will cap the carbon emission, and then you'll have to pay for anything above your cap. Now, the bill that was introduced last year suggested we pay $12 a metric ton, which would cost those people in Oregon $250 to $500 million. Now, where does the money go? It goes into the general fund. California has the exact same program. Their cap and trade program is $2.2 billion, and that was last year. 25% of that money has to go to help indigent people pay the higher energy costs. So I call it the Robin Hood tax. They're robbing my hood to pay for your hood. It's extremely expensive. Now here's a little tie-in. Who's going to sell the credits? Because we can't do it. We're not, DEQ can't handle it. There's a group called Western Climate Initiative.
NextGen.
Put together by the governor of California, the governor of Oregon, and the governor of Washington, and the prime minister, or what do they call them, of British Columbia. And they'll take a small fee. Anybody want a small fee of $250 million? I'd take it. But they will sell the credits. This will hurt our industry. As a matter of fact, there's a company over in Eastern Oregon called Ash Grove Cement. They put out 691,000 metric tons of carbon dioxide. They will be capped. If they drop down to a cap of, say, 600,000 tons, you know what they said they would do? Pick up and move. They will not do business in Oregon. Cap and trade is critical. Now, remember I mentioned Restore Oregon, how the utilities have already negotiated? Guess what? They negotiated out their part of the cap and trade. Everybody else has to deal with it. Everybody else that pollutes has to deal with it. In Clackamas County, there's 9 companies that will be impacted, which will cost them $4 million. And one of the biggest ones, Oregon Health Sciences University. They will have to pay a cap and trade. What do you think your medical costs are going to be when you go there to pay for cap and trade? And the proponent of this, my chair and my committee, says he's going to look forward to using the money to restore Eastern Oregon. So once again, it's the Robin Hood tax. Now, next slide. Are we already not doing what we said we would do, reduce carbon? Look at here, it's very hard to see, but in the year 2000, 70.8 million metric tons, that's what we did. In the year 2012, which is the latest figures, 60.9 million metric tons, a 16% reduction without a single law passed to make us do it. We did it on our own. And our trajectory is going down, but guess what? They show charts that show the trajectory is going back up. And I asked the question, well, how can that be? Because that's the latest figure we have. Well, they assume it's going up because we're getting a larger population. But in all of those years, we've gotten a larger population. And it's still going down. Yes?
It's the marijuana.
It's got to be the marijuana. Absolutely. And where they want us to be is down to 14.2 million metric tons. In other words, they want zero emissions from our state. And how do we get there? We get you out of your cars, and we either get you on skateboards or into electric vehicles. Because that's where the million electric vehicles is going to come from. Yes, sir?
Real quick one. Breathing. Breathing. Citizens of the state of Oregon exhale 9 million pounds a day of carbon dioxide.
But what they call that is a natural system, and it's balanced. We're here, we balance it. We do that. We can do that. Yes, sir?
Now, don't forget that the head of the global of the Oregon Global Warming Commission happens to sell those credits.
Oh, absolutely. But here's another thing. Because of this bill, because they want to do cap and trade, the Oregon Global Warming Commission doesn't work, does it? Because we haven't warmed. So they're going to change it. In the bill, they changed the name of it to the Oregon Global Climate Change Commission. Now, the Oregon Global Climate Change Commission wants $60 a metric ton. So remember I said $250 million at $12 a metric ton? Multiply that by five. $1.25 billion a metric ton. And as I said, California does $2.2 billion. This is what's coming, folks. Where will the cap and trade money go? They're going to actually form a new committee, and it's going to call the Environmental Justice Commission. And the Environmental Justice Commission will determine who's a polluter and who's bad. And they won't get money, and other people will get money. So basically, once again, it's the Robin Hood tax. You're robbing my hood to pay for your hood. California is taking some of their money and putting it into high-speed rail. Our money, you know where it would go? Bike paths? Bike paths. It would go into what we love the most, electric trains. But it won't go into transportation. That's the problem with it. And California, because the money is discretionary, goes into the general fund. California borrowed $500 million to balance their budget. What do you think Oregon's going to do? It's going to hurt Oregon tremendously because we will not have a fair advantage to the states around us that don't have it. Now, California is a huge state and a huge budget. But live down there and find out what gas costs you. It costs $3.85 a gallon. And that's because of all the stuff they've done. Next slide. So I would say, keep going, let's flip through that one. It's not good for our economy. Now, this is a mistake on there because I said Oregon, you know, when they have, when your computer spell checks for you and it automatically changes stuff. Well, that's what happened here. Where it says Oregon emits 0.25%, that's wrong. We emit 0.4% of the world's carbon dioxide. 0.4%. Now, in the Paris Accord, China gets to go from 11 billion metric tons of CO2 to 14 billion metric tons of CO2. Do you think anything we do in this state is going to make a difference? We're still on a trajectory going down. We're doing what we do normally. We're burning clean fuels. We're being very conservation-minded. But yet, whatever we do will not impact what China does. Steve?
If these pass, will they pass with only Democrat votes like the low-carbon fuel standards did?
Absolutely.
Everyone will know who's responsible?
Absolutely. There's no question about it.
Okay.
And this one here, this is a payback to environmentalists. Payback unions, now we're paying back environmentalists. Here's the one that's most important, and I've got 5 minutes to do this, and I will do this. Flip that. There we go. You've all heard of IP28. You haven't heard of IP28. IP28 is coming out from our Oregon. The
unions. What they can do for
now,
you.
Now, their argument is that we need this because we're short putting money into schools. And what IP28 is, it's a gross receipts tax. Now, they didn't want to say sales tax.
Which it is.
Because it's gross receipts. Whatever you sell, you're going to pay on. But it's not for us. And here's what you're going to hear. And I want you guys to think about this closely. You're going to see the guy, because remember Bell and Major 66 and 67? Their advertisement. A nice Learjet. The guy comes down with the expensive suit, the big rich watch, and the big cigar. And he says, he should have to pay. He's not paying his fair share. You're going to see those same kind of ads. And what they're attacking is large corporations, because they say large corporations don't pay their fair share. And so any corporation that does $25 million in this state will now pay the gross receipts tax. Once they hit the $25 million threshold, they will pay 2.5% of all their sales. Of all their sales. Steve?
Will it apply to utilities?
The utilities exempting themselves. Oh, speaking of exemption, I forgot this. Remember we talked about mandatory time off? Guess who's exempt?
Unions!
Yay! This is critical. This is critical. Here's how the system works. You've got a distributor. Say Fred Meyer's, Kroger. You know they get more than 25 million. They produce a food. It comes in. They get a 2.5% tax put on it. They give it to the warehouse. The warehouse gives it to the store. There's another 2.5% tax on it. The store does 2.5% to it. So it's a multiplying tax. It's just not a flat thing that says, okay, this is it. It multiplies down the line. So one product could have a 10% tax added to it. And those people that will be impacted particularly heavily are car dealers.
This is a value-added tax.
This is a sales tax. Car dealers, grocery stores that do large volumes, very small margins. Anybody who works in the grocery industry know that the margins are very small. When you peel off 2.5%, when an organization only makes 0.75% profit, you're going to kill them. You're going to bury them. This is done to what? Oh, remember that one slide where I said that we gave $628 million to the state employees? How do you think we're going to pay for this? With this tax. And you're going to see a lot of it. They're going to put a lot of money in. The unions will put a lot of money into this. Because they want you to believe that we're getting screwed. And the money that we're spending on schools is not enough. And we know it's not enough, but the Democrats control the purse. They're the ones not putting the money into schools. And they did put it in this session because they wanted to show that the schools were failing because they didn't get enough money. But you know, the very last day of session, we spent $1.2 billion, and we didn't spend a single bit of it on schools. This bill right here, when it comes out before you, they will say it will go to schools, it will go to social services, it'll go to the elderly. Don't believe it. It goes into the general fund, and I'm one of the guys that gets suspended. It will not go to schools directly. It'll go into the general fund, it'll get spread out, and schools will get some of it. Remember 66 and 67? Yeah. We're supposed to solve our problem, and it didn't do it. And this will not do it either. But what it will do is finance the union employees to make certain that they get their pay and get their raises. This is a bad law that will bury Oregon. Don't let anybody tell you anything different than that. 2.5%. Now, I want to point this out to you. Remember low carbon fuel standard. Remember Restore Oregon, electricity. Remember the cap and trade. That's three taxes on fuel. This is a fourth, because who else puts a lot of money in, spends a lot of money here, and puts a lot of product into our state? Gasoline companies. And they are over the $25 million limit, so everything that comes in here will pay for it. And guess who will pay for it? We will pay for it, because we will see even higher prices on gasoline. So this is a fourth tax on energy. And this will kill us. This will cripple our state. Mm-hmm. And this is, and lo and behold, this tax is $5.2 billion of biennium. $2.6 billion a year. So flip the slide. Here we are.
2.37 to 3.5 billion. Cap and trade adds 250 to 500 million. If we stay at $10 to $12 a ton, a metric ton, if we go to 60, that's going to be in the billions. We don't know what Restore Oregon is going to cost us in electrical rates. You just don't, and they even said that. We don't have it figured out yet. Gross receipts tax, $2.6 billion. So this is what it's going to do to our state. $5.22 billion to $6.68 billion a year out of our economy. And that's out of our pocket. That's out of our pocket because we will be the payers of this. Yes, ma'am?
So, who in Salem is trying to push this back besides you? I mean, you're telling the people, but who, do you have any power to stop this in Salem?
Absolutely none. Absolutely none. Because this bill right here, well, this is an initiative petition. So this will not come through Salem. This you get to stop. You get to stop at the ballot box. And I would tell, I hope that you would tell everybody that you should stop this at the ballot box because this will kill us. This gross receipts tax will kill us. Yes, sir.
What bills will be on the emergency clause this session?
Almost all of them.
Emergency clause.
How many will have an emergency clause?
This one won't because it's an initiative.
I know. Right. The other ones you mentioned.
This one will.
Yeah.
Cap and trade will.
Emergency?
They'll do an emergency clause. Absolutely, because they want it in immediately.
Give me a break.
Immediately. So, when all of this comes to fruition, this is what we look forward to paying. And remember, we pay everything. Corporations don't pay taxes. They pay on what we pay them for the product, and they have money left over and they have to pay, and it's called a profit. And as their profit goes down, their prices go up. We have to pay more, and our salaries aren't going to go up to match this. Yes, sir?
You see the legislature proposing a different bill to compete with IP 28.
I do, and the reason they're doing it is really kind of cool the way they do this. These guys are really shrewd. There's no question about it. Okay, I'm going to tax you $2.6 billion a year. But let me see, Mark Hess is going to come out and say, well, that's a little bit tough. So why don't we just raise your corporate tax by 0.4%? So you got to look at yourself. Do I want to pay this number, or do I want to pay something a lot less than that? Pay higher taxes. That's the scheme they have going, because they're trying to get signatures to put this on the ballot. Probably will make it. But if the legislature acts before that, then we've done what we want to do. We get more money out of the corporations because they're not paying their fair share. Yes, sir.
My impression of a value-added tax is that, like, the wholesaler pays his 2.5% on his sale, but he gets to deduct the tax that was paid up the line. If that's correct, this tax is far worse.
Yes.
Because the value-add is a tax on the value that you add to the product.
Right.
And this is a tax on the entire product at each step.
This is a tax on the entire product at each step, predicated on the fact that your corporation has to make $25 million or more. And they call what they call this is a minimum tax. And they're going to say, well, it's just a minimum tax they're going to pay. But if you do $100 million, you take $25 million off the bottom, you're going to pay 2.5% on $75 billion in gross sales. Now, your profits might not be that big, but you're still going to pay this tax. And that's the minimum tax you will pay. Yes?
Can you at least inject an amendment for free golf for all?
The gross receipts tax, I can't do anything about because it's going to come to the ballot. And you're going to see it. And you're going to see all the slick advertising. And I'm telling you folks, please, please, please keep it in your head that this will kill Oregon. And tell your friends, this will kill Oregon because all it's going to do is inject money into Salem. Now, Our budget is $19.5 billion for 2 years, right? $5.2 billion, it's a 25% increase to our budget, a 25% increase. This state can't handle that kind of financing. They just can't do it. Yes?
Alan, I just see this as an opportunity for a lot of businesses to move their distribution centers, like what we have at Clackamas.
No, it doesn't make any difference. If they sell it into Oregon, they pay for it. So in other words, we're going to tax Walmart. We're going to tax Apple. We're going to tax everybody that sells. If you sell more than $25 million into our state, we're going to tax you on what you sell into our state, wherever you are. Yes?
We should call this properly a sales tax. Oregonians have rejected the last 16 opportunities for a sales tax. We should never refer to this again as a gross receipts tax, it's a sales tax.
That's exactly why they put it on there, because they want to fool everybody.
Exactly.
They want to fool, gross receipts. Who would understand, who would just arbitrarily off the street say, I understand what a gross receipt is? You wouldn't, but it's a sales tax, it's on everything they sell. Yes, ma'am?
Is this coming up on the May ballot?
No, on the November ballot.
November ballot, okay.
November ballot. Tell your friends that this is totally bad for Oregon. This is gonna hurt your energy prices, your electric prices, and this will kill us too.
I think I hear John Galt.
Has anybody told OHSU what they're offering you?
They know about it. They know it's there, but you know, what side do you think they lean to? It's not this way. I mean, it's not this way. And that would be just, they would just come back to the state and say, hey, we need more money to pay for this.
You just got $1 billion. Right?
Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Do you have this information on your newsletter?
I actually have some flyers in the back. You can pick it up, and it's my PowerPoint. This is the first one I've ever done, by the way.
Woo!
See, my notes slide in and go around, they're kind of there. Yes, sir.
So are merchants going to be allowed by law to stick this on the customer's receipt as a sales tax?
No, absolutely not. No, it'll just be higher. You'll see it in higher price.
No, but could they put it on if they wanted to, or are they going to try to?
They probably could, but you're going to see it in higher price. And what this is going to do?
Yeah, I understand. You'll pay it.
What these two will raise the price of transportation fuel to get product to the stores. So these two are just going to vary. So anyhow, that's my excitement for 2016. So let's get out there. Let's change the way the state looks. And get rid of this job.
Thanks for looking
in. Alan will stick around in the back of the room and answer any more of your questions. If you want to get informed, Anne Marie, will you stick around as well?
Absolutely.
These are two really well-informed folks.
Thank you very much.